Welcome, everyone. Thank you all very much for travelling in this morning, some from not so far distances, some from farther away distances. But thank you very much for coming in this morning to appear before the committee and give evidence to the committee also. Can I just remind everyone to turn off their mobile phones? It does interfere with the system. And if we're able to even just be a bit a foot away from the microphone, I'm told that it's much better for the recording system as well. We have two apologies this morning, Polly McNeill and Matt Griffin. And I'll just go straight on to agenda item one, which is the work programme priorities. Excuse me. It's an evidence session, obviously, a round table, and this is the third final session that we'll have to gather the views of yourselves and other stakeholders and what the priorities and for the committee in this particular piece of legislation are. I would like to basically ask the witnesses, could they introduce themselves in turn?
In front of the Public and Commercial Services Union.
Hi, I'm Craig Smith from SAMH.
Hi, I'm Elodie Mignard from Scottish Refugee Council.
Hi, David Formstone from Social Work Scotland.
John McArdle, Black Triangle Campaign in Defence of Disability Rights.
Dave Moxon from the Scottish TUC.
Andrew Jackson from the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations.
Jim McCormick, Joseph Rowntree Foundation.
Thank you very much. Before I do start and ask the first question, I would like to put on record that I'm in contact with the Black Triangle Campaign in the context of a constituency matter, so I thought I'd put that on record at the moment. I'll just say the first question. In scrutinising the proposed legislation, what areas, if any, would you believe this committee should actually prioritise? And I'll open that to the floor.
So I suppose for SAMH, we really welcome the prospect of the devolution of a limited aspect of the social security system to Scotland. And the biggest priority for us would be the disability aspect, so particular DLA and PIP for scrutiny. We think there's a real need for a radical change in how PIP has been delivered at the moment, particularly around the assessment process, application process, and the support that claimants receive while going through that process. We've done a lot of work with our service users, kind of gathering evidence for our response to the ongoing consultation for the Social Security Bill. And there's a lot of issues that are similar that came up over the years with welfare reform, with the ESA, Employment Support Allowance reforms, and the Work Capability Assessment, that the assessments for PIP are having a really long-term negative impact on people's mental health. They're really not addressing people's mental health or recognising the huge concentration on physical abilities rather than people's mental health and the impact that mental health is having on their functionality. And there's a lack of support in the process. We've seen the impact that really good welfare advocacy and welfare advice can have in helping people through that process, but there's still a backlog in that and barriers to accessing that. We've been involved in a really good pilot funded by the Scottish Government through the Alliance on providing dedicated welfare advocacy support to people going through the ESA process, but also the PIP process. And unfortunately, that's no longer being funded after the pilot, but the results for that were excellent. People felt more confident, more able to express how they felt and express the impact that their health was having on them during the process, and got better results for that, with less need for appeals. We know the PIP process isn't working. If 60% of PIP appeals are successful for the claimant, there's huge issues there. And I think there's particular issues around people with mental health problems and fluctuating conditions and how that's not really recognised through the system.
Thank you very much. Yes, Andrew?
Well, I'll mention local housing allowance as a distinct area of benefit now, and that is something that I hope that the committee would look into, and we've briefed on that and sent the committee papers around that. But I have case studies which we're going to be sharing with MSPs more widely. I think we've got one for everybody but one member of this committee, which shows that some people will lose hundreds of pounds a month in their rent if they're in supported accommodation under the proposals. But I think that touches on a wider point about the way that the committee might choose to approach the government's actions in terms of the devolved benefit system. The consultation document focuses very heavily on the list of benefits which are being explicitly resolved, and it asks for sort of broad thoughts on what else might be done and how things like universal credit flexibilities might be used. But I think if the government starts from the point of dealing with exactly what it's been given first and worrying about the other stuff later, it's in danger of creating a system which replicates the problems that the current system has, which is that it's had things tacked onto it willy-nilly for decades, and that's why it's in such an awful mess. Whereas if the government can be creative about thinking what it might start off with and begin to plan around some of those top-ups or perhaps new benefits from the off and give some serious thinking to that, it's going to save itself a lot of trouble in the long term. And I'll give one practical example of that. The local house, the promise from the Department of Work and Pensions is that they will essentially, or at least their proposal at the moment, is they'll give a cheque to the Scottish Government and the Welsh Government to cover the shortfall created by their cap on local housing allowance for those who are in supported accommodation. Now, that essentially creates basically a grant pot, and it's not clear who will apply for that, whether the landlord will apply for it or the tenant will apply for it. But the and because this measure won't be introduced until 2019, there's one line of thought that says, well, we've got plenty of time to work out what we're going to do about that if the Scottish Government, we in the Scottish Government, if we were to receive that check. But in fact, that thinking needs to be done now, because there are a lot of problems with that approach, one of which is that the benefit system works on the basis of entitlement and money rises as need rises, whereas a grant pot is limited. But also, tenants in supported accommodation now know they're going, something is going to happen to their payments in 3 years' time, but they don't know what. So that's extremely anxiety-creating for them. And also, landlords who are thinking of building new or developing current supported accommodation simply don't know where the income's going to come from, what shape it's going to take. And when you're talking about building houses, 3 years isn't long enough time for them to go, oh, it'll be all right. It's the kind of thing that will make them think, we should wait and see. And if they wait and see that until then, it makes it even longer. So if the Scottish Government starts thinking creatively about that now, that's going to help. And I think that applies to their approach to the benefit system more widely. Don't think about what Westminster is giving you. Think about what you could do with the current powers available.
Helen.
Okay, thanks. I think in terms of the priorities of the devolved powers, as PIP, as disability benefits are the largest area, we'd agree that that's the priority to look at initially. I mean, there are three kind of key areas of PIP that we'd think that you should focus on. One is around the rates of the benefits, given that there's only two payable rates, and it's essentially excluding and getting rid of the lower mobility rate, which we think needs to be looked at as a priority, and it has an impact on motability as a consequence. The other areas would be the quality in terms of the involvement of the private sector, of the assessors, both in the way that they handle the assessments for the individuals involved, and ensure that committee members have all got horror stories and cases from their constituents on that. But how that affects in terms of the decision making when that comes back to people working in the DWP, looking at those decisions to get from assessment providers. That needs to be reviewed. And our belief is that the work should be brought back into the public sector, but also that the whole system needs to be reviewed to allow the staff processing the benefit to use and develop their skills and knowledge of the system, rather than just going on what an assessment provider says, which is the current situation. In terms of structure and staffing, structure, we believe there needs to be a full choice in how claimants can access services, both in terms of disability and health benefits, but also across the board. Staffing, we strongly believe that it's a key area to look at. There needs to be adequate staffing. You might be aware that DWP has cut 30,000 staff since 2010, and that's not because the work has been dropping. It's kind of the largest welfare reform in the history of the departments, yet they've cut that number of staff. The adequate and fair treatment of staff needs to be considered as well, because the DWP is a hostile employer towards its staff. The other key area I think needs to be looked at is what's not really included within the consultation questions, what the Scottish Government could do to mitigate the worst elements of welfare reform in either top-up benefits or reviewing what they can do to support claimants through the system.
Thank you very much, Jill. The next one is Jim McCormick.
Good morning. Thank you. So I guess my starting point in this is that the committee can really provide us a service by shining a very bright light on the purposes behind the new powers and in terms of scrutiny of government and how we're doing, really hold firm to points around purpose. For example, are these powers designed to compensate for the extra cost of disability or notional lost earnings from being a carer? Are they there to prevent or to mitigate poverty and so on? So really understanding and being clear about the purpose behind how the powers ought to be used. Second point is around universal credit, which Andrew has mentioned. This is the odd one in the powers because it's a shared power, a concurrent power in a sense, and that means data sharing between tiers of government. Really good, much better than we've seen so far, joint governmental scrutiny and working is really important. And I agree with Andrew's point about not waiting. Universal credit is here now. We have already some full service sites in Scotland. DWP has a test and learn approach. So I think we should be finding out as much as possible, not just about impacts on rent and the housing aspect of it, but how can we start to model the right way of payment flexibility and payment sharing within households? We think, for example, child benefit could be used as a gateway, a really simple gateway benefit for carers to be the default person in the household to be paid universal credit. Let's test that. Final point is about powers already devolved to Scotland. For example, council tax reduction. I know that another committee is looking hard at reforms to council tax, but we already have the reduction scheme devolved. There's much more we could do to improve work incentives to take the working poor out of the council tax burden that they currently have. And so I would just encourage you not to forget about powers already devolved, as well as looking at ones to come.
Dave Moxon.
We're surprised, convener, for you to know that we think the committee in developing its work and the government in developing its legislation needs to be highly mindful that we're developing a system within a context of work. The majority, the large proportion of people who will be claimants will be working, will have recently worked or will be aspiring to work, and therefore the Scottish Government's Fair Work agenda is absolutely vital to this. There's three aspects to that that I'd like to very briefly pick up on. The one is, I think it's widely recognised that a large proportion of employment in Scotland just now is precarious work. I met a woman last week who, at the age of 21, had had 22 different jobs, and the number of interventions that she'd had with the benefit system during that period are amazing. I was frankly amazed that she was still sane, let alone seeking work. So the quality of work is really important. That's really important because we will be designing new employability schemes, and those employability schemes have to have quality built into them. The worst possible outcome for people is to go into work and then in a very short period fall out of work again. The second aspect of the quality of work is retention. So there's a big burden on the public sector here, but there's a big burden on private sector employers too, to ensure that we have the best possible sickness management, the best possible supportive policies in place, and the best possible interaction between public sector agencies like the NHS and employers. The third one, and I think this is rarely spoken about, is quality of work for the people that deliver the service. One of our big aims here is to look at a simple service and a dignified service for the people that receive it. To really deliver on that, the workers who work in that situation also need dignity in work, and it has to be understood that in providing a dignified and a simple system, it may not look quite the same from the other side. These workers, and I'm a veteran of public service reform, as many people will be here, and we often hear very warm words about the expertise of the frontline worker being put to best effect. We need to find ways in developing this legislation where we actually listen to the people who are delivering the service, and hopefully in doing so, break down some of the barriers that we see in the benefits system, where we see confrontation between the person that delivers a service and the person that receives it.
David Fornson.
Good morning. I think another general theme, perhaps echoing Jim's point about the purpose of benefits, I think we outline within our submission from Social Work Scotland some of our concerns, I suppose, and a plea for the retaining a distinction, I suppose, between the devolved social security system of income maintenance and the wider social welfare system, including social work services. I think it's absolutely understandable that Scottish Government would wish to provide some kind of added value from the new system so that it's more than is being delivered by DWP. And it talks in its consultation about outcomes as benefits being a springboard for people, and absolutely they should be in terms of employment and other areas. I suppose our concern would be some of the contradictions that have grown up historically, as Andrew was alluding to, which is some kind of really a confusion between care and empowerment and monetary benefits. DLA, PIP talk about care components when often those benefits are not used to fund care. There's a fudging because many people pay a good proportion of those benefits into charges from local authorities for social work services. So, and there's references to integration of devolved benefits or alignment with other services such as social work and social self-directed support. And I think we would ask that is at least unpicked before we go down that road, that we would very much side with the views of disability organisations, which is that the primary purpose of benefits is tackling inequality. It's about income maintenance. It's providing for the additional cost of disability, and it shouldn't be, from our point of view, sort of combined with any kind of wider social welfare functions. Not that social work doesn't have a function in redirecting people, in supporting people on benefits, helping them back into employment and that kind of thing, but that we keep a clarity in terms of those two systems.
Thank you very much. Eloise?
Just to add to the point about the purpose and principles of social security system, as Scottish Refugee Council, we strongly believe that that should sit within a human rights framework that Scotland has already obligations towards, and to guarantee the dignity of people accessing social security, but also, as David mentioned, the condition of work of, you know, staff who will be delivering this new system. When we talk about human rights approach, we mean human dignity, we mean accessibility, and we mean equality. Evidence from our service of a three-year service that we published in June 2016 with Queen Margaret University, where 1,800 people accessed our service, showed the difficulty of accessing current DWP services for everybody, but especially for people who are new to this country, are new to any social security system, and do not speak English. There's a heavy reliance on organisations like us to navigate those systems, so this needs to be taken into account. Our evidence has shown quite considerable delay in processing benefits, which leads to destitution. With the devolution of universal credit, we really hope that the Scottish Government will explore a more efficient process, the current timeline, which is too long, and put people in destitution and serious financial hardship. And that should, again, you know, looking back at a human rights framework, mitigating poverty and guaranteeing human dignity should support that. For the universal credit payment, we also support options to have split payments between adults of the household to avoid issues around financial abuse. Again, a lot of families will have been through traumatic experience, which put a lot of strain on family life, and family breakdowns do happen, and we need to manage that effectively. The other point I wanted to make is about the personal independent payment, which at the moment refugees are excluded from because of a two-year residency criteria. CPAG has won recently a very good court case for a refugee child to be entitled to disability living allowance, and the DWP has not appealed, which is a success of the case. We hope that with the devolution, PEP will become accessible to refugees. Many refugees who, as part of the Syrian resettlement programme, refugees are chosen to come to the UK and to Scotland because of additional vulnerability, which often includes disability. And people who have been through the asylum process will also have other health issues which can be supported by personal independent payment.
Thank you very much. John McArdle.
I think, following on from that, I think the committee should look at all these issues through the lens of human rights. As it's well known, the UK special rapporteurs were here in Scotland last December to gather evidence because there's an ongoing investigation into the UK government for grave and systematic human rights abuses of disabled people under the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. At the time of the Scottish referendum, we were promised that there would be as near a system to federalism and home rule as possible. We made a submission to the Smith Commission, which demanded that all powers over Social Security be remitted to the Scottish Government, and that simply hasn't happened. Quite frankly, what we face, that disabled people are facing right now, is the catastrophic impact of cuts to their Social Security through migration from DLA to PIP. Let's not forget that when George Osborne stood up in the House of Commons, he declared that there would be a 20% reduction in the disability budget through PIP. So it was designed. It's as far away, the testing is as far away from evidence-based medicine as is possible to get. It's underpinned by something called the biopsychosocial model of disability, which is completely unscientific and not worthy of being used in a social security system worthy of the name. It's the same system that underpins the work capability assessment. It was imported from the United States, and Unum Provident, who were called by the insurance commissioner of California, who were told that they were operating disability denial factories and were banned from 50 states and fined billions of dollars, advised the UK government in drafting up this this test. So the Scottish government must reject the underpinning of both these tests. It must speak out more forcefully about the number of people who have died and committed suicide after a work capability assessment. We get reports from all over the UK that people go for a work capability assessment and consequently lose their disability living allowance on the basis of the answers that they gave to the work capability assessment. So there's that knock-on effect. It's a gatekeeper, it's a gateway. So I'd just like to say as well that as regards the work program, you're getting people who are disabled who are being found fit for work or put into the RAG group, and that's happening more and more. The goalposts have been moved. Our campaign began in June 2010 when a man called Paul Reakey hung himself after a work capability assessment in June 2010. And we've been campaigning solidly since then to try and make the system safer. It was our campaign through our medical advisor, Dr. Carty of Leith, who put forward the motion to the British Medical Association that the work capability assessment regime should be scrapped with an immediate effect, this was in 2012, to be replaced by a rigorous and safe system that doesn't cause avoidable harm to some of the weakest and most vulnerable people in society. So since that was passed and became BMA policy, we've sought to get that implemented. And the way in which we've done that is by trying to raise the existence of Employment Support Allowance Regulations 29 and 35, which give exceptional circumstances that where a person's, because of a person's physical and or mental impairment, there would be a substantial risk of harm to them. They should not be found fit for work or found to have limited capability for work. Unfortunately, because of an impasse on the contractual arrangements between the BMA and the DWP, our success has been limited in getting knowledge of these regulations put out there. There's local medical committees around the whole of the UK who are simply refusing to provide disabled people with the letters that they need to support their application, and the DWP refuses to build into the system despite some assurances that they gave, and also following a successful judicial review by the Mental Health Resistance Network, that the WCA discriminates against people with mental health problems. None of this has been put into place. So we still have people now who are being wrongly found fit for work, and who are committing suicide. And it's not just one or two people. You know, one death is too many. But when we're getting stories of people committing suicide every other week, and it's in the newspaper, we really need to speak up, because these human, flagrant human rights abuses are taking place on Scottish soil today. And I think that the Scottish Government must demand from the United Nations a copy of that report, which is only being sent to the UK Government. If human rights is devolved to Scotland, then our First Minister has a right to look at that.
Mr McArdle, absolutely take on board everything that you've said. I think a number of us around here obviously have had cases that you're referring to also. Could I just say that basically you're talking about disabilities, physical and mental disabilities, and certainly as the committee we could write and ask for a copy or of that report. And I just wanted to ask you, we have Damien Green coming to give evidence, and certainly we could raise that specific with Damien Green. Would that be okay just now? Because obviously I want to go round the table with others, or do you want to make another salient point?
Yeah, I would like to make a point.
Okay, it's just obviously the time is short.
I'll be very brief.
You'll be able to come in again, it's not a problem.
Very, very briefly, Black Triangle Campaign has submitted a report to Police Scotland, which has been sent to the Procurator Fiscal's office regarding the deaths of David Barr, Paul Donaghy, and Misty E, whose case was documented by the Welfare Commission, Welfare Commission for Scotland. We believe that an offence has been committed at Scottish law, that a public official, has willfully failed to carry out their duty. It's currently being looked at by the PF's office. And I'd just like to say finally that, you know, if disabled people cannot rely on the law to uphold their civil and their civil rights, then it's a very sad day for Scotland. And I would just, we just hope that the, as part of the 7-year action plan for human rights in Scotland, that all public agencies will put human rights at the very heart of their decision making. Thank you very much.
Ms. McArdle, George Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. I'd like to carry on from what John, because John's and Helen from the PCS have very powerfully told us about the inhumanity of the current Westminster regime with regards to DLA and PIP. And we've already had quite a bit of evidence with regards to this, because one of the bizarre things appears to be, and I'd like everyone to maybe kind of give me their ideas on it, is the fact that we were told by Bill Scott of Inclusion Scotland that 70% of the old DLA system was done as a paper exercise, effectively. And of that, only 1% were found to be actually fraudulent, which is actually probably the least in the social security system in general. And then now we're in a situation where we have 95% of them at face-to-face interviews, and the added pressure, and a lot of people dealing with the long-term conditions that effectively could end up, I can always use MS as an example, worry and stress will automatically give you an attack, and there's other conditions like that as well. But the cost of this, as it comes back down to Helen's, is 3.5 times the cost of what it was in the old system. Now, my question is effectively, we'll have a system here where, disabled people were effectively just a number as far as the Chancellor was concerned. They were making cuts and that was it. And now we've got a system, but we're finding it's more expensive and a private company is effectively making profit out of the misery of disabled people. As we keep talking about, I know they're strong words and the Scottish Government using dignity and respect, but if people say is there something radical you can bring to the system, if we actually do bring dignity and respect to the system, it's a good start. And I just wonder what some of the people, especially John and Helen, have got to say with regards to what I've just discussed there as well.
Helen Flanagan, do you want to come in?
Yes. In terms of the involvement of the private sector in PIP, I mean, it did exist within DLA as well, but as you said, it was largely a paper exercise. And you're right, it is face-to-face assessments. What we experience, our members, just to remind the committee that we represent the vast majority of people working in the DWP, which is about 54,000 people in the UK. What they experience a lot is that they receive a form coming back from that assessment, which is a PA3 or a PA4 to be technical, and that may not have enough information, then they have to send that back to the assessor to carry out the assessment again, not face-to-face, but do the work, then come back to the individual who does the processing, which again is another cost, which is something that, and more time for the claim to go through, which is not fair on the individual claiming. It's surprising, really, that ATOS and Capita were given these contracts, given their history with the WCA, and John has obviously given quite a few examples of the disastrous impact there for people claiming benefit, but people around the table will also be aware of the huge backlogs that happened when PIP was set up, sometimes going on for 8 to 12 months, that people were having to wait whilst that assessment took place. The other point to make in terms of assessments and the private sector as well is that when an individual makes a claim to personal independence payment and they want to provide additional evidence because they fear that assessment won't be adequate or full enough, that they are required to pay for that medical evidence themselves, which again is going to have a detrimental impact on people with low income. As I said in my opening comments, our position is that this work should be brought back into the public sector. It's absolutely abhorrent that there are companies making a lot of money out of this, and a lot of money out of people waiting and a lot out of people's suffering. If there is to be an assessment system, that could be done within the public sector, within the NHS, and then processed by people working for the government. So that's our experience from members working in the DWP, and that's our position on that.
Thank you very much. First of all, I just think I should say that I don't think it would be wise for anybody to comment on individual cases that are live in the Scottish criminal justice system in this forum, because I think we should let the criminal justice system do its work. But I wanted to pick up on two points that were made by David Moxham and Jim McCormick in their earlier remarks. I was very struck by what David Moxham had to say about two things that he said. First, the importance of the quality of work in the devolution of employability schemes. We had a debate in the chamber yesterday afternoon about exactly the devolution of employability schemes, and a number of us talked about the importance of sustained job outcomes in good quality jobs. The question is, how can we design a devolved employability scheme we all want this, right? I mean, irrespective of party, irrespective of background, irrespective of we all want more people in work. We all want more sustained job outcomes, and we all want more good quality employment. But how do we achieve it? So that's the first question. Second question, to David Moxham, I was very, very struck by what you said about the importance of engaging with people, not only people who are reliant on these services that are being devolved, that's essential, but also on engaging with people who deliver this service. And I just wondered if you knew the extent to which the Scottish Government has been engaging with, for example, DWP staff in terms of the listening exercise that they're currently embarking on in preparation for their, as part of their social security consultation. And just to Jim, I was very struck by the very powerful point that you made, Jim, about not overlooking the social security powers that are already fully devolved before Smith, before Scotland Act 2016, and in particular thinking about council tax. And I just wondered if you could say a bit more about the sorts of things that could be done but aren't being done in Scotland at the moment, about, I think, what you called incentives to take the working poor out of council tax.
We've came off on another track here because we're actually talking,
We're just following up on evidence we've got so far.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine, Mr. Tompkins. So I would need to bring in Mr. McCardle because he wanted to reply directly to George Adams and Helen's question. So, John, did you want to reply to that? And then it's Alison Johnson and then...
Yeah, in reply to Mr. Adams' question. Black Triangle campaign and our sister campaign in England, Disabled People Against Cuts, signed a memorandum of understanding many years ago with not long after we began with PCS Union to campaign jointly against the
involvement of private for-profit companies in the disability assessment regime. I think the consensus is absolutely unanimous across the whole disabled people's movement in the UK that they must go. Not to mention the often criminal behaviour of the companies concerned, talking about Maximus, its history in the United States in the court system is absolutely appalling. So we don't want any of that. And last week, I watched the proceedings from last week of this committee online, and somebody spoke about rights and responsibilities. Well, I'd just like to say that that cuts both ways, because government ministers, in particular the Secretary of State, has a legal responsibility to respond to senior coroner's prevention of further deaths report. So I'd just like to put that on the record. Thank you.
Alison Johnson. You're next, Alison.
Thank you, Convener. I think a lot of the earlier discussion was about SAMH and the Scottish Refugee Council in your submission spoke about the need for advocacy. And I think in your introduction this morning, Elodie, you sort of highlighted, I mean, not even just appealing benefits decisions or whatever, but being able to access the system in the first place. And I wonder if you have any views on how we make sure that people in Scotland are able to access a Scottish security system in an equitable and fairly straightforward way. Is it about a greater investment? Do we have enough advocacy services at the moment? I'd be interested to hear your views. And if I may, Convener, one thing PCS highlights in, you've suggested a welfare charter in your written submission. And I just wonder what kind of rights you think a charter should include, because it may address, you know, some of the aspects of ensuring that people are treated with dignity and respect.
Did you want to reply to that, and Helen Flanagan, in that specific? Did you want to reply?
It's absolutely right. The need for advice, support and advocacy is just at the stage of making a benefit claim. In the holistic integration service, which we ran from May 2013 until June this year, so we've got 2.5 years of evidence of how people have been accessing the benefit system in Scotland, and we thought that initially the service was designed to give more support to people who had higher support needs, and to encourage people who speak English and understand the system to navigate the system on their own. What we found is that everybody needed us. So that was quite striking. The main issue with new refugees is that when somebody is granted leave to remain in Scotland, they receive a biometric resident permit, which is their ID card. And there is a protocol between the Home Office and the DWP to issue national entrance number. We've also evidence that this protocol is not functioning. As part of the Scottish Government New Scot strategy for the refugee integration, we've been working very closely with the DWP to review those processes. So there is a recognition amongst statutory stakeholders that something needs to be done. The reason why I mentioned the national entrance number is that 80% of refugees will claim job seekers allowance, which is a claim that is done online. But the system doesn't work if the person doesn't have a national entrance number. It's an IT problem that is not being fixed. So this is a practical issue that has massive consequences. So people need to make a claim online on the phone. And so somebody who may not speak English or have good English, but the welfare language is a different language, so people will struggle. The DWP is very compartmented with contact centre, benefit delivery centres, no way to have a face-to-face contact, and these processes are extremely difficult to navigate. There are complex questions about savings and shares and bank accounts abroad and everything that people are not simply understanding. So we have to sit with people for an hour and a half phone call to make a benefit claim. Then there will be delays because on average it will take at least 28 days to process a claim of job seekers allowance. By that time, the Home Office support will have stopped and we will assess people to access a crisis grant from the Scottish Welfare Fund, which again is a fund administrated by Scottish Government and local authorities that is accessible via the intervention of third sector organisation. So we are a recognised organisation to support people to claim crisis grant. We are, again, the application process is a phone call or an online application. And there is no access to interpreters on the phone. So these are the kind of resources that we talk about. To answer your question on, are there enough advocacy services? It's a difficult one. I would be tempted to say not really. Our funding stops in June. We're lucky to have secured further funding, but we have therefore been running a limited service to in the summer, referring people to Citizens Advice Bureau who couldn't cope.
Helen Flanagan, do you want to come in on that particular one?
It's a question.
Yes, and then Dave Moxham and Jim to answer Adam Tompkins.
Thank you.
I'll just try and be brief. The welfare charter concept that we refer to in our submission is something that we go into greater detail on in our response to the public consultation. And we have PCS Unite Community Represent Unemployed Workers, and the Unemployed Worker Centres combine have put together a welfare charter public document which sets out some ideas that the Scottish Government could look at and consider. Within that, there are, well, as detailed in the submission, at the heart, and it goes back to what we were talking about at the outset, at the heart of social security systems should be the desire to eradicate poverty and lift people out of poverty. But also within that should be clear rights for claimants. So one of the concepts there would be a claimant's ombudsman, how claimants can get help through the system, but also the right to fair and decent work and not being pushed into precarious work as well. There is a DWP customer charter. I'm not sure people are aware of that, but isn't really something that is very strong or that's something that individuals can rely on. So we're talking about something much stronger, both for the Scottish Government and for people administering the system, but also for the people claiming the benefits.
So, Craig, did you want to come in slightly on that particular one and then Dave Mox?
Yeah, it was just a quick point for Alison's Johnson's question on advocacy. I suppose our position is there isn't enough advocacy support. We know from speaking to our service users that there's a huge backlog in accessing advocacy and welfare advice. But there are different models you could do about that, and part of that is about resources. It will be need to be resourced. We know in mental health law, you have an automatic right to an advocate. I think that's something that should be considered around people engaging with the social security system and an automatic right to advocacy. Again, there would be a significant resource attached to that. But it goes back to my earlier submission. We know advocacy works and can make a real difference. So as I was saying earlier, I was on the National Steering Group for the Alliance Welfare Advocacy Project, which was a dedicated welfare advocacy project funded by the Scottish Government, delivered locally through four local advocacy projects, providing support to people through the Work Capability Assessment and the PIP Medical face-to-face assessment. And the difference that made to people's confidence going through that, ability to speak with confidence and assessors' behaviour as well, was huge, and it made a big difference to the results and the need for appeals. But that's no longer being funded, which is a shame. So I think, yeah, there's a need for investment in advocacy.
Thank you, Alison.
My last little point there was, obviously that is part of a sticking plaster too. The fundamental thing is getting the system right as well about face-to-face assessments. Mm-hmm. We wouldn't need such a demand in advocacy if we reduce the number of face-to-face assessments, and there's a huge need to reduce them dramatically. As has been said before in evidence earlier, why 95, 96% of people who are applying for PIP are having to go through face-to-face assessments just does not make sense, particularly for people with long-term progressive conditions or significant conditions, including some significant severe enduring mental health conditions.
Thank you very much. Dave Moxham, do you want to try to...
I mean, I recall the questions. In reverse order, you asked really our knowledge about the extent to which the government might have shown willingness or begun to engage directly with those that deliver these key services. And the answer to that is, and to be fair, at her instigation, we have had a preliminary discussion with the minister precisely in that area to look at what type of forums we can create, which will use some of the expertise of those who deliver on the ground, bringing it together with those who are the claimants, those who actually experience that, to see if we can get something positive coming from that. There really is no better way in public service, in my view, than to get the experience of the claimant, but then to get the experience of how that operates at the front line. You then asked me to redesign in 5 minutes an employability system for Scotland. Okay, thanks very much for that. I mean, just a couple of reflections on that. I mean, it has to be said, and we talk about resources a lot, then 8 million or 28 million with the government's additional funding is not a lot of money to start with. I mean, international evidence, European evidence indicates that significant investment in people, which has the lasting outcome that is needed, is the most important thing. And we massively undervalue the cash value, and I don't like talking about cash value all the time, the cash value of that front-end investment, as long as that job sticks and as long as that job is suitable for the person. I think there's an enhanced role for the public sector as an employer. I think the public sector can do more to provide the safe places for people who are returning to work. And I think that there's more the public sector can do to directly intervene. I'm a veteran, again, of the Future Jobs Fund, which was created by Alistair Darling in the eye of the last recession and of the many inadequate responses to that particular crisis. One of the more adequate ones was the very clear aim of job creation to boost the economy and job creation to help people who are further away from the jobs market. I mean, just finally, and I suspect we'll probably take a different view as to the extent to which government and government agencies should intervene in employment matters. We do have a whole range of agencies out there, whether it's FitNote, whether it's Access to Work, a whole range of agencies who, to some extent or other, take a view about the quality of work or adaptations that may need to be made for work. There's a very strong argument for looking about how that can be pulled together and made more coherent so that there's a genuine empowerment, if you like, of those who are providing the pathways back into work to make serious and clear recommendations about what sort of work needs to be provided, particularly for people who are on the long-term sick and going through occupational health rehabilitation.
Jim McCormick, you wanted to answer specifically that question.
Thank you. So, Adam, on your point, so just briefly on employment services, I think there's lots of good quality international evidence from very different countries, for example, Netherlands and Australia, of decentralised systems, which progressively have got much better at sustained job outcomes and progression. And I think in Scotland, we should try and leapfrog the lessons of work programme, work choice and all that, and set a new high-level incentive for our services, which would be about earnings progression. Not off benefit, not 6 months in work, but are people attaining and moving on to high quality training and the best possible wage they can command for their skill level? That's a very ambitious long-term goal, but it's that kind of different purpose that helps to start shifting outcomes, and it does need adequate resourcing. That's the kind of obvious point. On council tax reduction and rebating schemes, a few points to make. First, I think it's really important in Scotland and Wales, actually, that we haven't gone down the route of localising schemes. So we have a great advantage in being able to have a coherent national scheme with local delivery. The problems, though, are take-up remains low, especially for older households. As an aside, we could probably almost end pensioner poverty if everyone was claiming the entitlements to which they were eligible. So take-up is a big issue, and the evidence is take-up campaigns nationally don't work. Local face-to-face, local media, those are things that work much better for low take-up groups. There's a question about adequacy and uprating I don't think we've had a proper debate in Scotland about on what basis we uprate every financial year the adequacy of council tax rebating. And then there's a point about, does our rebating take adequate account of additional costs? Most clearly for households with people who have disabilities, perhaps with children, I think the Scottish Government has a very welcome commitment to improve the rebating scheme for low-income families with children. But we could do much more around the taper rate, and this is the point about people moving into work. Council tax debt, legacy debt, gets chased down very quickly when people move into work. It often undermines work incentives because people are often carrying debts they couldn't pay in the past. And so looking at a fair form of withdrawing support as people start earning to maintain work incentives, and a fair treatment of legacy debt. These are big responsibilities already within our powers in Scotland.
I have a whole list of people. Some have just jumped in there on the specifics. Gordon, you want to come in on that specific because you have been waiting a while to come in.
Yes, in fact, thank you, Convener. It actually was a question for Dr. Jim McCormick, and you've just touched on the question of work incentives. The constituents that I speak to who are unemployed, claiming benefits, and able to work, want to work, and usually don't have any difficulty with most of the things that people here have said today, but they want to see a system that works for them and that doesn't take away their ability to get into work when they can. And I think that's what you've just been touching on. How important in the overall context do you think maintaining work incentives is for these people?
So I'm not an expert in all this evidence, but there are certain groups in the population for whom the return on every hour worked is particularly important. There's very good evidence that single parents, for example, we know this for the last 20 years when employment rates have been rising, every pound and penny earned that can be retained from work matters hugely in the work opportunities and decisions that those kind of households are able to make. There are various things in this mix. I've mentioned local tax, rents is in there too. I mean, high housing costs, not least in this city, but other parts of Scotland as well, can be the tipping point that undoes the calculation that says you're better off in work. Most people, because for most people, you know, basic benefits are not very adequate, most people will be better off in work, all things being equal, but they're not equal. High housing costs, high childcare costs, transport costs. It would be a very illogical decision to choose to commute a very long distance for low-paid work because you're going to be worse off. So understand the nature of the local economy. I think there's no route to inclusive growth in Scotland if it doesn't involve higher quality work in the care sector, retail, hospitality, tourism, food and drink. These are the growth sectors with the problem of low pay, high turnover. And although it's an issue for your other economy, your other committee, sorry, Gordon, around inclusive growth, I think understanding the interface between these new powers and for those who are of working age and are able to work, understanding that trade-off is really important. And final point, a big thing we can push on in Scotland is really bearing down upon the costs people face, because solving poverty is not just about boosting incomes, it's about holding down the costs that low-income households face.
Gordon, did you want to come back in that one?
No, I think that's answered. Does part of what you were talking about, a local approach, I think you're referring to, how does that come into this? Obviously, we can take a local approach in the sense of taking a Scottish approach with the new powers to at least some extent. Are you thinking in terms of locality beyond that to local council level? How would you see that developing?
I guess the starting point would be to understand, and I'm addressing here in particular the position of low-income households, low-paid households, the working poor, who are half of all households in poverty. The nature of the work that they can feasibly access is almost always quite local. And so understanding in a typical local authority or city region, what do the powers look like around transport costs and regulation, around training, on the job, high quality training, how the childcare market operates, really mapping these out quite locally. There's a different question about where the powers lie potentially, but really understanding what does the decision making look like? What do the opportunities look like for people in those positions? We best will in the world, and governments and parliaments aren't the best ones to understand those experiences, but the more we can draw upon good evidence, good advocacy, input from people who are in these positions. As a lot of the cities in the north of England are now starting to get their act together and doing, I think we'll be in a much stronger position to make this stack up locally.
Want to come in then, Ben?
Yes, just very briefly on some of the points that have been made. I think that some of the points that Mr. Adam and Mr. McArdle made indicate that we don't want to end up in a system where the issues with the way that the DWP operate now migrate to the system because of the over-reliance on the current setup by the Scottish Government when it's trying to implement this new system. And I think that's very important to recognise. I know that the Minister has spoken about 15% versus 85% devolved benefits and how difficult the transition is going to be, but I think for the committee that the nuts and bolts of that will perhaps be something to pay close attention to, because otherwise we'll end up in a situation where the principles are completely compromised by the operational aspects of the system. To pick up on Mr. Tompkins' point, I think there are many good examples within the third sector, certainly I know more widely, but certainly within the housing association sector of employability schemes, where the nature of the interaction between those supporting people and the people who are looking for work is fundamentally different from some of the other schemes that have existed in the past. And I'd be happy to put members in touch with RSLs and others who operate these schemes in Edinburgh, for example, Port of Leith, I know, have a good one. And to pick up on that again, the point about advocacy, I think if we to go back to my earlier point about a holistic system, if we begin to think about a system which involves things like advocacy and employability as part of the social security system, as opposed to thinking of them as adjuncts to a sort of rigid, here's your money transactional system, which we may or may not fund depending on what cash we've got available or not, and start thinking about the fact that if Scotland's going to design a social security system based upon the principles that were outlined by Mr. Neil prior to the election, it should and can encompass those things from the off, rather than simply saying, let's take the DWP model and bash it about a bit and hopefully it'll look a bit better and stick some stuff on the side, as opposed to starting almost with a blank sheet and saying, how can what the powers we're getting, how can the money we're getting contribute to the vision we have for a social security system, and start from that premise, or more robustly start from that premise, rather than thinking, as I say, how do we just fix what we're getting given?
Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, all. There's been powerful comment about the conditionality and sanction regime around benefits in terms of for disabled people and other vulnerable groups. But I wanted to touch on two points, Convener. Conditionality and sanctioning, first of all, in respect to the employability programmes. PCS note quite powerfully in point three of their written evidence that we want to create up an employability programme that should be about support, not penalising people, and I'd be interested to hear more comment on that point. And around that and the employability aspects of what we're considering, I just wanted to pick up on what Jim McCormack said about the interface of new powers and how we think about how these new powers integrated within the reserved matters, and also pick up on what David Moxham said about security of employment and quality of employment moving beyond the social security system into work. I'd be interested to just hear more comment around, in terms of mitigating claimants and customers coming up against the sort of cost that Jim McCormack mentioned, how important is quality work paid at a real living wage in a secure environment? And how detrimental are things like, for example, zero-hours contracts and other aspects of insecure work?
Ben, I think Helen had wanted to come in on that earlier. And then, Dave, did you want to come in?
Yeah. Thank you. In terms of the question around employability and the work programme and sanction, I think it's reasonable to say that the work programme in the UK was a disaster and a huge waste of public funds. It didn't work for the vast majority of people who were put through the work programme. I think 70% returned to the DWP afterwards. All the data we've got shows that between 2011 and 2014, only 3% of the 1.5 million who referred to the work programme found lasting work, and only 18% found at least 3 months or 6 months work from that. It also had high levels of sanctioning. So if you to compare periods, data for the same periods, that people were found to be 5 times more likely to be sanctioned than they were in 1 year alone, 2014, than they were to find a job from 2011 to 2014. So it was ineffective, but there were high sanction levels with it. So, I mean, there's lots of other research and data you could look at which proves and establishes that sanction is an effective way to get people into work, and I think that's largely agreed by many around this table, and we were pleased to see that that's something that the Minister also said in her recent appearance at this committee. So we would welcome the Scottish Government progressing what I think they've already indicated as recently as yesterday in removing in the conditionality from the employability side of things. It's a shame that the powers don't go further so that you couldn't look at removing conditionality and sanction from the employment system as a whole, but we think that needs to be looked at. I think in the comments made about the work programme, I was going to ask to come in about employability, because I think that shows as well that using the private sector and third sector isn't an effective way of doing that. There's data to show that people would be more likely to have found work if they didn't have any support from the work programme at all. So we believe that a better employability system would be delivered by the public sector, and the range of ways that could be done. It could be done within job centres if they were better resourced and people were allowed to support people better. It could be delivered by Skills Development Scotland. There are whole ranges of options within that. I just want to comment very briefly on about DWP engagement, because there was a question, and given that we represent people who work there, I thought it would be relevant for me to answer that. Dave Moxham is entirely correct that from the Scottish ministers, we have had engagement as a union who represents people who work in DWP. However, you probably won't be surprised to hear that from the other side, from DWP, there's been very, very little engagement, both with the union and with the staff working in DWP in the UK and in Scotland specifically. It's quite a worrying time for people who work for DWP, because it's just so unclear to them what it means in terms of devolvement. So I think, if anything, if you could look into that and encourage, you know, you don't have powers over than DWP to step up that. Thanks.
Dave, did you want to come in? Yes. Dave Moxham.
Touch on a couple of points that Ben McPherson raised. I mean, with specific respect of employability in a labour market where there aren't enough jobs, with essentially a target-driven employability scheme, it's a bit of a seller's market. So if you're one of these people, as Helen says, possibly in the private or voluntary sector, and you're looking to hit your target, then there are disincentives to be flanked to check the quality of employment that you're placing somebody in. Now, I won't go into detail here, but there should be some very clear benchmarks. Putting somebody from an employability programme into a 0 hours contract job makes little sense. It also makes sense to go a bit further than that and look at the general level of security of employment, of hours and of wage rate, because the quality of that job is going to matter in terms of the likelihood of it being sustainable. So again, and as I referred to earlier, there is an interventionist role for these employability schemes, which is why I think Helen makes a very good point that the direct sector can should and can play a key role in this. It's also why the public sector needs to look at itself as a provider of those jobs, because at least we do have certain provisions within the private sector, not always adhered to, but generally adhered to in terms of security of employment, in terms of wage rate and the rest of it. Now, some people might look and say, that's a bit unfair on the general public who don't all have that particular level of security. We are looking at tailored solutions that are meant to be lasting. And if they are tailored and if they are lasting, then being frank and going back to the money, the saving for the public purse in the medium to long term is quite significant.
Jim McCormick, did you want to come in there? And then Ruth Maguire. So
on Ben McPherson's question about quality of work, especially relatively low-paid work, we know from our evidence, from Oxfam's Decent Work Programme in Scotland and others, that people's expectations are often very modest. So, of course, there's an aspiration to be paid a living wage, but beyond that, aspects of quality of work are quite small things like predictability about working hours. So if you've been working on average 15 hours a week for the last year, then employers being willing to say, as a minimum, we will guarantee you 15 hours work a week, rather than leave people not knowing from one week to the next, or following recession, lots of contracts go on to from permanent to temporary and never switch back to permanent when they could, in terms of how the business is doing. So there's something really, really important about the human resources function in companies, about middle managers, about spotting people who are poorly skilled but could benefit from progression support. We've come across workplaces in Scotland where staff are permanently locked out of training opportunities, for example, care homes that have permanent night shifts, and the training's always on during the daytime. So there are things about rotas, shift patterns, predictability of hours. And just to make this even more complex, we need to take a sector-by-sector approach, because what this looks like in the care sector is different from retail, it's different from the hotel sector, and so on. And I think there's no shortcut other than really understanding what's happening within the wiring of those kind of companies and those businesses, and paying attention to what's happening in workplaces where staff don't have union protection. So finding other routes to employee voice, especially for low-paid workers.
Did you want to come back in, Ben? And then it's Ruth. Okay, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener, and I appreciate all the written evidence and the what we've heard this morning. It is very powerful. I think it's right that we focus so much on the people who are using the system and who need the system, but I really welcome a bit of focus as well on the staff that are having to deliver services, and it's kind of on that I'd like to explore. How do we rebuild trust in the system when we have it, both from clients' perspective and from the staff side as well?
Anyone want to start off in that particular one? Helen Flanagan.
I'll try. I think that from the staff perspective, I think I probably will start with, I think there has to be a complete redesign in terms of how the agency would be structured, look at kind of the terms and conditions involved. We are pleased to hear the Minister's idea about co-production. We're in discussion with civil servants about what that might mean, and it's something that we're exploring so that staff have a key part in designing the system and the structures. And how it would work in terms of the benefits themselves. I think it's going to be difficult to address some of the cultural problems that arise from the DWP because it's only going to be partially devolved, and for the main of it, the front-facing side of the benefits system is still going to be under the DWP in the form of job centres and the majority of working age benefits, of course, are reserved with the DWP. So I think, where possible, having access to DWP front-facing officers would be a benefit. So having some kind of front-facing element of the Social Security Agency. Now, that doesn't mean setting up necessarily new workplaces. One thing DWP is looking at as part of its overall kind of body of work at the minute is co-location. Now, some of that is arising because of mass office closures that are on the horizon from the DWP, but having a positive influence within a DWP workplace, I think, would be a start of that. But for the main of it, I think it would be that looking at the co-production, having that involvement in designing the system, ensuring that there are fair working conditions, adequate staffing, and fair policies for people working within the department. Because as has been said before, you can't really hope that you'd have the users treated with dignity and respect if those delivering the services aren't also treated in that way.
David Moxon, then Craig Smith, want to come in?
So just a really short observation, harping back to all of the discussions that we've had over the years about public service improvement and change, is that a confident workforce, by which I mean a workforce that's confident of their own security of employment and remuneration, is a far more positive participant in positive public sector change than somebody who's frightened about their job. It's just as simple as that.
Craig Smith, you want to come in?
Really difficult to rebuild trust, but I think there's a few things that can be done. I mean, in the recent research we've been doing and focus groups of our service users, that was probably the key thing that came out, was just a complete lack of trust in the system through a kind of legacy of the work capability assessment and ESA process and now the PIP process. I think crucial to it is, on the staff side, is good training. We know that, well, we're still hearing a lot about really quite distressing experiences that people are having at that front line when accessing benefits or doing assessments, really quite stigmatising experiences. And training has a huge role, particularly around disabilities and some of the specifics around mental health and helping someone when they're in crisis. And I think there is an opportunity with the new Social Security Agency when it comes to kind of try and really have a co-production approach, as Helen was saying, with staff, but also with those using the services, disability groups, disability organisations and others, to really try and build a different culture, because it is really cultural and that takes a long time to change. There's also something about managing expectations. We know that people who are receiving things like PIP or carers allowance may well be receiving ESA through the DWP process, and it's about really good quality information for claimants, because it's a challenging time for people who've been through multiple reassessments, multiple changes in the welfare system, for another change to be happening. And change really does need to happen, but it needs to be communicated in an accessible and understandable way for people, and with people having plenty of notice around any changes. But I think training is really key, and co-production, and really listening to the voices of people who are experiencing the system as it is. So yeah, but a challenging one. I think it's not going to be overnight. And then there is a huge thing about managing expectations and understanding that people will be navigating two systems. And kind of related to that, but the wider, our wider point is the real need for good quality information sharing processes. That's something that came up strongly when we spoke to people around. It was something that when I was carrying out focus groups, that I was a bit unsure how people would respond when we were asked how they would feel about public bodies sharing information about their health or maybe some of their social care aspects, to really make a more informed judgment about a PIP claim to try and not have a face-to-face assessment. And overwhelmingly, people were very keen that information is shared about them, if that is with consent and in a legal context of data protection. And I think that can be used in a trust-building measure as well, around trying to navigate the system to reduce the need for face-to-face assessments. It's really good, high-quality information sharing, but that's difficult to manage and needs to be done properly and legally.
Thank you very much. It is a difficulty, I suppose, but I'm sure we'll get round it, hopefully. But it was very helpful about the data protection. John McArdle.
Thanks. We're keenly aware that the budget for the work programme was severely cut, I think, by about 85%. We're also keenly aware that the block grant has been cut by 10%. So, because obviously, ideally, what we're doing is we're trying to petition for mitigation of cuts and bridging arrangements to be put in place until PIP is being operated by the Scottish Government. And we would just like to ask that,
because we think that it's a defining feature of our society in Scotland, how we look after people who are sick and disabled. So we would just like to see that prioritised, and we recognise the difficulty financially that that will pose, but I think that where there's a will, there's a way. In terms of, I appreciate what has been said here about advocacy, the importance of advocacy. For example, the Citizens Advice Bureau in Leith is currently facing great difficulties. They're trying to raise £20,000 to stay open. You know, it's absolutely critical that people get the advice that they need. We would love to see the establishment of a disability law service or a hotline where people who are having problems could be put in touch with agencies that can help them, because we know that where people do have advocacy, the likelihood of things having a good outcome is much, much higher. And in terms of sanctions, we would like to see a complete end to sanctions. We believe that they are a violation of the fundamental human rights of individuals. It is a human right to be able to eat. As Ken Loach said, hunger is being used as a weapon. We were horrified to see, if I'm not mistaken, in the Scotland Act, that an instrument which is used to devolve power to Scotland actually imposed an obligation that saying the Scottish Government must not mitigate where a DWP sanction has been imposed. We would like to say that the sanctions regime is itself unlawful, we believe, under human rights legislation, because in the determination of an individual's civil rights and obligations, there must be access, under Article 6 of the European Convention on Human Rights, there should be access to an independently constituted tribunal. And that doesn't happen under the present system. So I think that needs to be challenged. And I think that where people are sanctioned and having to, you know, are basically made destitute, relying on food banks, that the government has every right to step in to protect people whose human rights have been breached in this manner. I would urge the Scottish Government to consult with the government lawyers' legal service at this issue. Finally, before I leave today, I'm going to present this to you, Convener. It's a book called Cash Not Care. It's by Mo Stewart, an ex-Women's Royal Air Force veteran. 6 years of work has gone into this. It is, I believe, the most authoritative account of what's gone on, and a textbook example of what not to do with a social security system. And I would recommend that every member of this committee gets a copy of this book by Mo Stewart, because you'll find it absolutely invaluable going forward in your work.
Thank you very much, Mr. McArdle. We don't usually get advertisements, but that is not a book, that is information, which I'll be very glad to read.
It's evidence.
George, you wanted to come in at a very small point because I have another two speakers. And
kind of frames everything that we're discussing here, especially with the work programme, in so much that 87% of it, the budget has been cut. And I was interested in what Helen said, the fact that the work programme is a disaster, has been a disaster. That's completely opposite of some of the members around this table mentioned in a debate in this place yesterday. You know, the part of the reason we were told, led to believe that it was cut because it was so successful. You know, that people were in work and that it actually moved forward. So, you know, it's interesting for you being and your members being at the coalface, effectively, and you're saying something entirely different from what the ruling Westminster government is saying.
Point taken, George. Jim wanted to come in and then...
Briefly and practically on your point about trust and this point about co-location, just one thing we're doing, which I think hopefully is will be of interest, we are supporting a demonstration project in Glasgow. It's in Springburn and Parkhead. It's a co-location model. It involves health centres and two job centres for the first time. And it's a really simple model of bringing together, you know, opening their doors to housing advice, debt advice, childcare and training support, the kind of things people need under one roof. So not referring people on to multiple agencies or come back next Tuesday morning when someone can see you. It's real time. It does crisis responding as well as giving people opportunities on to what they're looking for. And you know, the fact that DWP is supporting two job centres to be involved in it, I think is potentially really significant. And we can tell you more when we've got the results.
look forward to that. Certainly the debate and the Minister and others, members have mentioned, we need to look at a much more holistic approach, because obviously everyone's got a knock-on effect, and I'm very aware of that, particularly in the benefit system. Ms Mignard, do you want to come in on that one?
To add to the question on how to build a system in which people have trust, I totally agree with what's been said already about it's going to take time. But I think the first thing to think about is about clarity. At the moment, the systems, whether it's the Scottish Welfare Fund or DWP system, are not clear for people. And taking the example, the specific example of refugees, when they engage with the job centre, they just see another governmental official. They see a lot of similarities with the Home Office because they engage with the DWP every 2 weeks in the same way that they did with the Home Office. It's again another organisation who give them money, and if they don't go and sign, the money is cut. It's an organisation that has a reputation of being punitive. So these are similarities. So refugees need time to understand what is the role of DWP. And in our work with the DWP, this is something that we work on a lot. A work coach will need to explain what they're here for, what do they do, what is their purpose. So clarity is very important. All the points about co-location will also help, because by bringing together different organisations, which will avoid people to be ping-ponged to different places, it simplifies the system. Advocacy, we talked about it. It's important that this is independent advocacy. However, there could be ways of working as well with third sector organisations, not necessarily to be in those places, but that there is an easy access from those places. Again, to build trust is the principle of not being non-punitive, and everybody have talked about sanctions, so I will not dwell on this. The last point I want to make is it's a system that needs to, and that's going to take time, needs to think of the diverse needs of the Scottish population. We heard about training, and yes, training is necessary. We have been involved in delivering some training to DWP. Training is not enough. I've met DWP staff who understand the issues. The next step is how do we make those changes applicable within the environment they work on? So we go back to the work environment and the system in place and the structure that DWP staff or benefit agency staff need to meet.
Thank you very much. It's been very, very interesting. Some lot of good questions and answers also. I think what's came out of it is, yeah, we do need clarity. We need people to work together. In the case of the staff I've met, as others have, DWP staff, they want to do their job and want to do it properly. They're hindered at certain aspects of it. And obviously, we need to make sure that everyone works closely together in a holistic approach as well. I've not got enough time to get into some of the stuff that I wanted to raise, but I'm sure that it will come up eventually. But we need to make sure that people are treated with dignity and respect. And as Mr. McArdle says, that these horrific instances are not revisited again. I'd just like to thank you all once again for your contributions. It's been excellent. And I'll close the meeting just now for 5 minutes for the witnesses to move and a comfort break for the committee. Thank you.